basic world of understanding to each of us in our own way. May we be blessed and may we bless others with our work. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Thank you, Charlie. And I'd like to just go over the seven principles that we follow at the First United Spiritualist Church. The first principle is we believe in the fatherhood of God. Number two is the brotherhood of man. Number three is the communion of spirits and the ministry of angels. Number four is the continued existence of the human soul. Number five is personal responsibility. Number six is the compensation and retribution hereafter for all the good and evil deeds done on earth. And seven is eternal progress is open to every human soul. So we've embraced a quote given to us by a spiritual entity called Silver Birch, who was channeled by a British medium called Morris Barbanel. And Silver Birch says that our allegiance is not to a creed, not to a book, but to the great spirit of life and its eternal natural laws. So I'll ask everybody to send their love, light, and energy to Charlie as he gives us his reading.
Thank you, Dave. Now, what we're going to do today is we're going to have a short reading from a book called The Seeing Eye, The Feeling Heart, which is the story of natural mediumship as written by Will Ford and Linda Muir, who are longtime members of the Spiritualist National Union of England. I read from chapter 11, Will's vision of vision. Dreaming is an act of pure imagination, attesting in all men a creative power which, if it were available in waking, would make every man a Dante or a Shakespeare. Nothing so much convinces me of the human mind as its operations in dreaming. By natural tendency, all men are dreamers. The laws of evolution demand it. Life flows through us through our dreams. Whether we are asleep or awake, a great amount of our time is used up with dreaming. Why? Because the dream is the interlude or the bridge which enables man to emerge from the cold, dark night of oblivion, of not understanding, and enter into the full warmth and freshness of full life and vision. In fact, men are so caught up in the events of their dreams, they hardly know where the dream begins and real life begins. What goes on inside his head is of more significance to each individual than the life teeming around him. Man, the dreamer, burns up his power, skill, and talent in fighting the shadows and shams, phantoms and bubbles of his make-believe world. He struggles to the point of exhaustion in a vain endeavor to stave fictitious evils of his own dreams. Such is the power of vision. When we open our eyes, we take for granted our ability to see, assuming sight to be the faculty of the physical eye. But the optics of our faculty of not seeing is not itself vision. Seeing is the result of one of the most complex and sensitive of all creative processes. Yes, of course, the eye is essential for sight. It is through the organ of the eye, so sensitive to light, that impulses, or messages, if you like, are sent to the brain with information about the state of the outside observed world. But the transfer of information is not sight. The interpretation of the information is the sight with which we are familiar. This becomes clear when we see something alike of which we have never encountered before. We shall have trouble seeing in such a thing. In fact, we may not see it at all because we have no means of interpreting the information we receive. We might disregard it entirely. There is a story that when Captain Cook arrived in New Zealand with his sailing ships, native accounts of the visions describe the ships in detail, but made no mention of the sails. The natives did not see the sails because they had no experience of the concept of sail, never mind its reality. Instead, they were amazed at the mysteriously powered vessels. What we see, indeed what we can see, is determined by what we think. This means that not seeing is not automatic or mechanical. It is literally a creative process. Such a sensitive and creative process is complementary to the vision of dreaming, and so to the more advanced vision of wisdom. Thank you for listening. We will now have a song, and then I will begin the address. Just bear with me one moment. For those of you who are interested, that was Roger Hodgson from Supertramp, Lord Is It Mine, a song that for years has inspired me to go a little deeper into the energy, to go a little deeper into self, in trying to understand the nature of the soul and the nature of Charlie. The reading where we talked about Captain Cook and the natives not seeing the sails on the boat takes me back to a time in Phoenix, Arizona, when I was sitting by my pool a few years ago, lost somewhere in thought. Somewhere deep within, a voice said to me, "This is all about bungo pie." Now, I thought that was kind of strange. And I guess it is. So I went to Google, our new universe, and I said, "What is bungo pie?" Bungo pie actually turned out to be a New Zealand language of the Maoris in the 1800s. Bungo pie means, quite literally in Maori, glad tidings. So what did I find? How was I inspired to hear that voice of the spirit in a language that I had no familiarity with? You see, in the quiet solitude of contemplation, meditation, we move into that state of vision that is beyond vision, beyond our physical eyes, which bring us the concept of the physical world. And the vision of the mind is that world within, worlds within worlds, where we find true hope and true inspiration for what we really need and what we do when we go beyond needs and wants. A want was a new iPhone. It's a beautiful machine. That was a want. Was it a need? When Steve Jobs conjured in his mind a vision of a computer right here, he didn't have this. All he had was his inner sight. And it's remarkable that at Steve Jobs' funeral, the only book that was on his iPad was Autobiography of a Yogi by Paramahansa Yogananda, a man of God, a man of inner vision who spent his entire life in service, devoted to the God of his own understanding. And if you happen to read that book, you will be amazed at the events that Yogananda described 100 years ago before he came to North America. A true visionary. Yogananda, Steve Jobs, you. What do you envision in your life? A humdrum world of social gossip, social media, the news, the latest trend, TikTok of all, whatever that is. I'm too old. Thank you. I don't understand it. And now Google's talking to me. Okay, that's fine. Vision. Your vision of life. Beyond the four walls of your existence, beyond the four walls of the prison of your own mind. How do we go beyond? Isn't that really life's purpose, to understand who and what we are. Who and what we are. Will Ford, when he was 16 years old, had decided in himself, this would be in the early 1900s, that he did not resonate with the church that his parents were taking him to. He was from Wales, small town. Someone convinced him that he should go off to one of them spiritualist meetings. Now, I don't have a good English accent, so I'll just use my southern one there. So he went. And he went to this thing called an open circle. And when he went there, he wound up giving a communication that someone else understood. Now, he had no previous knowledge of what a spiritualist church was. In fact, most people even today have no knowledge of what a spiritualist church is. Oh, those just those people that talk to the dead. Well, I can tell you that that is absolutely wrong. Because I know in my heart and in my soul what the spirit world has taught me in the last 20 years is to live this life fully, completely, fully and completely. We live the joys of life, the joys of inspiration, the joys of those inner visions that seem to come to us out of nowhere, just like a daydream, seemingly a different reality. Worlds within worlds, however you want to describe them, they're a place that is of yours, within you. And as we go into the visions, we understand the visions are created by the screen of the mind, that very, very active organ that controls this physical reality that we live in and allows us to hear, to see, to know, to feel. We go beyond that. We still use those physical qualities to interpret our visions, and we understand that in our vision, we create life, we create a scene. Now, sure, some of it can be fantasy. Oh, what I'd like to do. Oh, how I love to be right now in the Tower of London looking at the jewels. Wouldn't that be grand to have a spiritualist meeting in there? But that can't happen, or can it? If you go back to the autobiography of a yogi, everything can happen. There is no duality. There is no other world and this world. It is all worlds. It is all possibilities of life. So if we accept that premise that there is no duality, why do we have a physical world? Why don't we just go back and forth? We will, at the end of our time, we will go. And then we'll come back, possibly as a message, while we live our life in the next world. Knowing that life is eternal, life is continuous. We are spirit with a body in this world. In the next world, we will be spirit. We were energy before we came into this world, with an understanding of who we are as a human being. Each of us unique, each of us different, but yet we come together here in common agreement of only seven things. Seven, not five. I don't have seven fingers, I don't think. I haven't counted them recently. But we do agree on seven principles of life, the fatherhood of God. But we don't tell you who God is. We don't have a book that defines the words. We have a principle that allows you to understand as you do. No one no more, no one no less. It's your understanding. Now, I know from my own family, those who were quite religious made it to the other side. And I know that those who never uttered a word of God made it. So do we need God? That's a question you have to ask yourself. I know what my answer is. For me, since I have adopted spiritualism, my life has been eternally better. And my understanding has changed. We have a very famous philosopher in spiritualism. He's an American born in 1826, Andrew Jackson Davis. He had 6 weeks of formal education, yet he wrote 33 books, all of which were dictated by the spirit world, most of which are all still in print. But one of the things that Andrew said was, I do not want to be the man I am today, tomorrow. I hope to be more. And then the day after that, more again. And so it goes. That in the road of spiritualism, there is no beginning, there is no middle, there is no end. It's like the long yellow brick road of Dorothy's life back home. The things that she encountered along the way that helped her to find what she needed to find to go back home. Isn't that beautiful? That no matter whether we be a saint or whether we be a sinner, we're all the same when it comes to God. He doesn't judge us. We judge ourselves. He doesn't let us down. Sometimes we might let him down, but he's certainly a patient father. In the case of yours truly, for sure. Always look at yourself with a little bit of humor. Always look at yourself as a work in progress. Don't live with regrets. Let go of those things that no longer serve you. And if you find that as you progress along the road of spiritualism, that your views change and you suddenly don't seem to resonate with all of your friends, you'll know why. You'll know it because you've changed. You've allowed that process of enlightenment to come into your life. And I could never tell you what to become, who to be, how to be. You have to do that for yourself. You make your choices. You follow your visions. And when you understand that a vision can become a reality, like Steve Jobs did for us, then you may have created something special. Now, he created something special for a lot of people. We only need to create something special for one person, that be ourselves. That we take this life that we live it to the fullest. We go through our ups and downs just like everybody else, but at the end of the day, we come back and we say to ourselves, okay, that wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. And then maybe you take a couple of minutes at the end of each day and say, how did I do today? Did I serve as well as I could? Did I help? Or perhaps when I've not had the day that I wish to have, I might say, well, I'll try again tomorrow. I'll do my best, I promise. And who am I promising? I'm promising myself right here. Me, my own truth. You must live your truth. In the face of the gales of society, of those who wish to tell us how to be, of those who think they know better, of those who have the popular trends, of those who are the rich and the famous, of those that we observe on the television and all the media stars. Oh, what did that person have to say? Well, you know, that person might be a very fine actor, but he may be a lousy communicator and have no philosophy of his own. But yet you do, the humble little you, coming back into self and opening the door to your own garden, walking in, sitting down, just like you own the place. Because you do. You built it with your own hands. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Charlie. That's very inspiring. I really enjoyed that. And like you said, when the Indians didn't notice the sails on the boats, that was something new to me, but in a way, it felt right. It felt like I knew this all along, but it's just it needed to be brought forward so that I can remember it again. And I love your message that we have to be true to ourselves, that it's ourselves that count. Everybody's responsible for themselves. So thank you so much, Charlie, for sharing today.
Thanks, Dave. Remember Bongo Pie.